Hey dubes, how are we doing today? Welcome to the weekly dubisode where we just catch up, have some fun news, and in a time of uncertainty, we just gotta really take care of our loved ones and play catch up here. So yeah, we do the dubisodes every Wednesday. Just want to give a huge shout out that everyone who has joined me recently and has really given me full support on all the live streams I've been doing. And just full disclosure, we're not playing Plague Tale Innocence. We're just having a little background music. And of course, on the weekly dubisode, this is a gaming channel, so I just try to keep it as gaming focused as possible. So we're just having some lulling sounds of the Plague Tale. Really great game, by the way. It was a game that had slipped under the radar for me that came out last year and was on a PlayStation sale, so figured I'd get to it. So yes, thank you so much, everyone. I'm just trying to get to the content as soon as possible. So let's just get into the weekly news. But of course, I think I have a good segue here. So I'm going to start off with the entertainment piece for the week. Usually it's the movie of the week, but I think I'm going to cheat a little bit here just because of a really good segue moment I have here. As well as I just amazingly love this series, but I just want to say thank you again for taking your time out of the day to join me here. So let's get right into it. But yeah, I've been rewatching a series here, a spinoff of a series that I just can never seem to get enough of. I always seem to watch it at least once a year at this point. And of course, I'm talking about our beloved, our gritty, awesome, enticing tale of the Breaking Bad universe, really. For us to start it off, Vince Gilligan and Peter Gould, amazing writers. They used to do work on the X-Files. And we have, starting in 2008, Vince Gilligan started this little show on AMC. God bless AMC, by the way. I didn't really like him as a kid, but I really did grow to learn to appreciate what AMC's content was really focused on. So, yeah, we have Breaking Bad started in 2008, and then it was an amazing show. Just lasted five perfect little seasons, and then a little bit later, fans just couldn't get enough. They wanted more, and then we got Better Call Saul, the spin-off series that deals with Saul Goodman, the criminal lawyer. That was a pretty prominent character in the original Breaking Bad series, and there's just the characters. You will never be so enthralled in great camera work, great character development. I mean, Peter Gould and Vince Gilligan really did take a lot of work and time and thought. It's not just your typical average willy-nilly Mr. Roper sitcom. I'm talking real grit, real foreshadowing and real, just, you know, things to look for, small details in the background of the camera work. It's really just such, both Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul, and it's really great that Better Call Saul actually turned out to be amazing. I wasn't really into it at first, but I just also have to plug this really quick. This episode is brought to you by Arizona RX Energy. They're just so damn good when they're cold. Just had to cleanse the palate there. It was just really good that Better Call Saul was actually a good show. I wasn't really into it at first, but it's one of those shows where the more you watch it and you know what you're looking out for, you can really appreciate it more, and then, you know, kind of connect the pieces yourself. And the foreshadowing is just spot on, and the characters are just so real and addicting to watch play on screen, and that's really due to not only the amazing writing, but the characters that live out these lives, and I'm talking Aaron Paul, Bryan Cranston, even the smaller roles, Dean Norris, and talk about fan favorite Mike Ehrmantraut, John Banks, who's actually been in all of the only character who has been in every Breaking Bad universe piece, including Breaking Bad, Better Call Saul, and we even got the technically the Netflix exclusive movie. I think it actually did come out in theaters when this was back in November or December. I think it was December when they released the Breaking Bad movie, El Camino, starring Aaron Paul, and kind of more of an in-depth look at Jesse Pinkman. I'm not going to really get into spoilers, as this is just a true universe to behold, and every piece that you really watch is just addicting, and it's because it's just a really well fucking written show, start to finish. It doesn't drag itself on. It doesn't try to be a money-grubbing asshole of just continuing the series just because it's popular. Kind of like we've seen in Walking Dead. I really hope that show can find its stride. I heard it's gotten better. I kind of fell off in Season 8, and I've kind of missed the last couple seasons, but I guess there's some really cool things going on with Negan. It's farly dragged out from what the comic book was doing. I'm not even sure where the comic is. I think maybe Robert Kirkman has come up with some sort of ending there. But I digress. The show just really ended where it needed to be. As far as Breaking Bad, there's still one more season of Better Call Saul. We just did see the season 5, and of course, with everything going on, it's really hard to just film things. It seems like really the only shows and movies we're getting is things from like HBO and Disney Plus, and maybe shows that were already filmed and they just had some post-production work fill out for them. But if you've never watched Breaking Bad or even Better Call Saul, it's its own flavor, Breaking Bad, but you still really get the characters that are, well, I'd say introduced in Breaking Bad, but are really introduced in Better Call Saul. This is a prequel spinoff of the show. And just talking about really amazing group of people that you can tell really just want to entertain you and give you a great show and a great hour of your life well spent every Monday night. And I really hope that Better Call Saul Season 6 wraps it up all in a nice bow, because it seems like Better Call Saul will be the last Breaking Bad universe piece, at least for the foreseeable future. We'll see, but I don't think Vince Gilligan would create another piece if he didn't see like there was a real importance of making a whole nother show or movie based on something. But I'm really glad we get Breaking Bad, El Camino, and Better Call Saul, and they're all on Netflix. So if you have Netflix, give them a look. Otherwise, it is on the AMC channels. I can't stop talking about this show. I really can't recommend it anymore. I'm not really much of a TV show guy. Of course, I grew up, Saturday morning cartoons, and I watched Digimon, and I had to know what happened on the next Beyblade. But that's just me. Speaking of Netflix, there's some really enticing anime shows that have been produced specifically from Netflix, like the most recent one I'm thinking of, Earthquake, Japan Earthquake 2020. I kind of was watching that a little bit, and they're just beautifully, really artistically driven shows. And there's another survival one I'm thinking of, but I can't quite put my finger on it. But yeah, Netflix, I got to give a huge shout out to for Netflix having such a great anime selection. I actually did watch One Punch Man on there finally, and if you're a fan of anime and just are really looking to get more of maybe like a Dragon Ball Z type experience, man, I could not stop watching. Definitely watch the second season, and definitely can't wait to see what's happening there. But again, I digress. I just like to kind of word vomit all my ideas, and if you're looking for something to watch, I really would just like to recommend, because I'm pretty picky when it comes to my shows. So and even some of my friends who were even pickier than me even got into Breaking Bad. Huge shout outs to Jeff for always having fun. So yeah, if you're really looking something right now, especially when we're still quarantining and inside, and you really need something to take your time, and you just want to watch a show and give your hands a rest from all the dirt gaming that you got going on, really watch Breaking. I'd say if you can, watch Breaking Bad first, then watch Saul. And then watch El Camino somewhere in there. Don't watch El Camino first, but, I guess really either way, it can really go either way, just because, Better Call Saul is a truly great spinoff and could be watched first, but maybe the impact is a little great. It really all depends up to you, how you like, your pie, your dessert first, or your dinner second, or vice versa, whatever you're there. So yeah, I just want to get that out of the way. I know this is a gaming channel, but we do gotta take our little hands, give them a little break from all the gaming. Sometimes you gotta sit back, relax. So I like to start off with the movie of the week, and I think this is a great segue into the recent presentation we've had by Ubisoft. Yeah, the Ubisoft Forward live, or the, I guess, a virtually live event was on July 12th. I didn't actually watch the actual show. It sounds like a lot of people got some great insider info, even got a lot of demos and betas to a lot of upcoming games. So I have a list right here. I'm finally getting everything all squared away where I can easily swap between live and computer. I'm just getting more comfortable with it. So thank you so much for taking your time out of your day and just listening to me to rant about cool IPs and franchises and really just get excited. But I will give you the news here. But yeah, we had the Ubisoft Forward, and sounds like they kind of started off with smaller things. I guess we're getting a Just Dance 2020. Man, I remember them showing Just Dance back in the day in like 2010 with the Kinect of all things, and really just not being a huge splash at the show. It really just doesn't work live, really. Something you kind of have to experience in your own living room. Otherwise, it does look super janky. And of course, I'm looking at you, Kinect Animals. Jesus. What a trash show there. But yeah, then we got Mythic Quest Raven's Banquet, The Crew 2. That game kind of fell under the radar, but yeah, a lot of kind of add-ons or maybe teasers for some of Ubisoft's already established and released IPs, like The Division 2, Trials Rising is, I guess, getting some DLC, Ghost Recon Breakpoint. Of course, I always have to make the joke about Ubisoft Radio Towers that we're getting in, that we always gotten in Far Cry, but I'll be back to that. But yeah, then we finally saw some Watch Dogs Legion gameplay that looked, I guess, really cool and innovative, and that you can play as really anyone, and you can hack anyone's phone, and I guess you kind of want to pick and choose the right people to hack into because they all have their own certain abilities. I think that's a really cool idea. I don't think we've really seen anything like that. I mean, of course, we've seen, you know, heroes take over bad guys' powers and that classic trope over and over again. But to really be someone else at any given moment with using the classic Watch Dogs style gameplay with your phone. I actually did play Watch Dogs 1 and I really enjoyed it. People were really comparing it to Grand Theft Auto and it really wasn't Grand Theft. Kind of like how people always say Sleeping Dogs is like the Japanese or Chinese Grand Theft Auto, but really it's not like that. Grand Theft Auto and Rockstar is always going to be its own open world thing. There's no you can kind of compare, like, kind of when Saints Row is supposed to be the GTA killer, but I think developers have hopefully learned that there is no Grand Theft Auto killer. That game is always going to be an existent masterpiece that cannot be overtaken. But, so yeah, again, kind of getting off topic here. But yeah, Watch Dogs Legion, it seems like it's really adding some cool things. Of course, that does have its drawbacks. Seemed like, of course, all these titles are still supremely in development. And yeah, this game was supposed to come out in March, but it was pushed back to October 29, 2020. And is going to be launching on PS4, Stadia, and PC. And then I guess there will be, I think Ubisoft is going to be free upgrading most of their titles to the next gen if you buy them. Because it seems like, so I will talk about this in a little bit, but Watch Dogs Legion looked really cool. They showed some new Brawlhalla stuff, kind of, it kind of looks like an indie game, but they always seem to be adding, I think Ubisoft maybe picked it up, but they've been adding a bunch of characters to this 2D melee like fighter, Hyperscape, and then we get to the big ones here. Yeah, they showed some, we get a better look at Assassin's Creed Valhalla. For the November 17th release, Ubisoft has exclusive collector's editions on their store. I think the Assassin's Creed one is sold out, but it was cool to see It's really an evolution of Assassin's Creed Odyssey, but when I look at it, it's really just not Assassin's Creed anymore. It's kind of its own. I guess the developers really said they want you to feel like a Viking. And yeah, we did see the thing in the trailer where he brought out the switchblade on his wrist, but it's just really what they did with, you know, even Origins. Origins was kind of an RPG upheaval, and then they really expanded that in Assassin's Creed. I played Assassin's Creed Odyssey. It was super cool. Didn't finish it, but got enough to realize, okay, I can see where this is a lot more accessible to a lot of modern-day players, and it is kind of, in a way, just another open-box world type game, but, you know, it's really the setting that sells these open-world games, and all the minute details that guys like Digital Foundry really see and showcase there. And I'm going to do a huge appreciation video for a lot of my favorite YouTubers here. And I've been horrible about tagging them, but really just want to give them a shout out here really quick. But yeah, Assassin's Creed just doesn't seem like Assassin's Creed. I remember back in 2007, man, when they had that amazing E3 presentation and the Eagle Dive, and you actually had to be super stealthy and really just hone in on the guy you were going to assassinate. And now it's just some sort of brawler beat 'em up in a backyard alleyway, kind of a little bit. But, you know, that being said, I do like what I see. It's just not an Assassin's Creed game. And I think maybe what happened is Unity and Syndicate just really bombed super hard, and I think Ubisoft took a long hard look at kind of the IP as a whole and really needed to do more to modernize it in a better way. So yeah, very cool. It seemed, you know, like kind of like your classic RPG. You'll have special moves with certain button combinations, and you'll be dodging and parrying, and it looks like you'll be chasing down, instead of shanties, you'll be chasing down tattoos to actually put on your character, and I guess you'll actually be able to choose between a male and a female, and I do like that addition. I was just saying with, I recently streamed Erica, and I really do like all this showcasing of female heroes and very strong female protagonists and antagonists in a recent video game, so I do like that. But I guess there is always a canon, like Alexia, I think that was her name in Odyssey, is the canon, and Alexios was the guy in the previous game. But again, I'm digressing. Like what I saw with Assassin's Creed Valhalla, definitely looks like just kind of another RPG, but you know, maybe someday we'll actually get maybe that more Assassin's Creed classic feel, because even with Assassin's Creed 3, they really kind of turned into a huge Warzone type experience. But yeah, and of course, this was my initial segue for the Breaking Bad universe thing. Yeah, we actually have Giancarlo Esposito, who plays none other than Gustavo Fring in the Breaking Bad universe, is not reprising, but he is actually being the main villain in Far Cry 6. And we didn't get any gameplay from Far Cry 6. I did happen to pre-order my collector's edition on the Ubisoft store. You can only get that in Ubisoft store, but there is the GameStop exclusive Ultimate Edition, and then there's the Steelbook Gold Edition. And I kind of am a little annoyed that we're seeing like five editions for one game. Even now we're seeing, especially with the THQ titles, I have my Battle for Bikini Bottom Rehydrated Shiny Edition, and then there was a FUN Edition, and they're doing the same thing with Destroy All Humans with the Crypto Edition. So I'm talking like a $150 edition versus a $400 edition. I mean, I just don't really know if that's an easy, justifiable price, especially when people are trying to save up for the next-gen titles, but we'll get into that shortly with the PS5. I do have PS5 news coming for you. Just wanted to talk about this Ubisoft event. And but yeah, I'm actually really excited for Far Cry 6. I'm not a huge Far Cry guy. Of course, actually, speaking of, yeah, our man Michael Mondo, Nacho Varga Ignacio, who's in Better Call Saul, was pretty much the premier bad guy in Far Cry 3 and actually really sold that game. I'm talking, do you know the definition of insanity? I'm talking about that whole monologue that we had. And man, what a great performance by Michael Mondo. He was in, of course, Spider-Man. He's kind of rumored to play Scorpion there. So I'm just loving that we're getting all this extremely amazing talent from the Hollywood, you know, coming into video games. And of course, so we're getting, yeah, Giancarlo Esposito is going to be playing the main villain in Far Cry 6. And I think I'm ready to give Far Cry a true another chance. And yeah, the radio towers, I'm hoping it's more than just from one radio tower to the next. And I actually really was more apt to buy this collector's edition. It comes with the ultimate edition, comes with a replica flamethrower. You know, I'm all about my collector's editions. I have to get them. But yeah, so it seems like every Ubisoft game, if you get the PS4 disc, you'll actually be able to pop it in your PS5, and there'll be a free download patch upgrade with all the new stuff that I guess is going to be added. And I'm sure they'll have PS5 physical discs for Assassin's Creed and Far Cry and Watchdog Legion, all these other games that are coming out. I'm sure they'll actually have a PS5 discs when we get kind of more of a concrete time on those releases of those consoles. But it's just good to know that Ubisoft is doing something right. You get the PS4 discs, you get to enjoy it on your PS4, and should you keep it or trade it in, you still get to have that same experience, since even though you just bought the game once, and we're seeing even more news like that with Cyberpunk 2077, and I believe there's a lot of other games that are doing that as well. Not EA. It's, I don't know. I mean, I think there's a free upgrade from like January, but they have, you know, terms and guidelines bullshit. And they're even, I think the next NBA 2K21 is $75 or $70. I don't know. It's unclear if that's just for the base game, but we've been seeing pre-orders for that already. And yeah, EA is really fighting for their loot boxes, I think, in the UK or in other places. It's kind of becoming a mandatory mask thing where it's like, hey, you better get your shitty-ass loot boxes out of here, or we're going to give you the hammer and the fist. And I'm not talking in the mouth. I'm talking up the asshole. So get your shit together, EA. Just, you know, I actually do got to give them props. I guess Digital Foundry was really kind of praising them for spitting out all these sports games every year. It's such a somewhat high fidelity when that's, you know, that's really hard to do. Games are just getting hard to make. So it's not like they're doing everything wrong. They're just doing a little scummy and just scummy, period. But I'm just really glad that Jedi Fallen Order Star Wars was a really great game. Really solid Dark Souls adventure-like experience. And it sounds like they're doing a sequel to that game. They even gave out some free DLC. What the fuck? Like, keep doing that. But it's just good to see that EA is not completely... Of course, it was, you know, developed by Respawn Entertainment. But let's just keep it going there. I guess we're getting a Squadron game going on later. More of a vehicle-based Star Wars game. Kind of like, I believe it's called Jedi Fighter. But only time will tell on that one. So yeah, I got the Far Cry 6 collectors $200 later. But really excited to just give the Far Cry experience another run. Giancarlo Esposito looks amazing in this game. And it sounded like overall Ubisoft had a pretty good presentation. Overall, I guess, you know, there's a couple things here and there that didn't go so well. But, you know, what are you going to do when you got to give a virtual live experience? It's just kind of hard to do that these days. So yeah, really excited for Far Cry 6 though. And really cool that it's Giancarlo Esposito. I was really excited that, you know, when we saw that Norman Reedus was starring in PT, and then of course that got canned, but he was still working with Hideo on Death Stranding. And then we got Mads Mikkelsen and Lea Seydoux and even Jennifer Wagner. I mean, some sort of weird obsession with Hideo Kojima there, but really cool nonetheless. So let's just keep it moving on here. Ubisoft, kudos to you, really excited. So yeah, we did have the really amazing June events for the PlayStation 5, the actual reveal. The Xbox had a semi-reveal before that, and Xbox is going to be having July 23rd, a full-on games event that they're going to be showcasing more of their first-party games. They'll probably, I guess they're going to have some real huge surprises. Phil Spencer, I actually really do like Phil Spencer. I think He really gets the people going. No one knows what it means, but he gets the people going. Type attitude, and it's, you know, Xbox has had the hard long trail of really making backwards compatibility a thing. I wish there was more of that. This is primarily a PlayStation channel, but I really wish it was easier to play some of the old school games. There's only a handful of PS2 games, even smaller amount of PS1 games that you can actually download on your PS4. So it sounds like we are getting some backwards compatibility with PS5, PS1, 2, and 3. Maybe they'll have more of a PlayStation Now and expanded experience like that. I'm actually really happy that the games that they have on there, I just wish maybe you could download them more. But again, you know, that's only the technology that's actually built within the console. It's just easier to have that more of an Ethernet wired connection type experience, but you just gotta have good internet. I mean, and I'm not even talking like okay internet. If you want a really smooth experience, you gotta get that Charter or AT&T bullshit if you really want to have a smooth gameplay, especially when you're streaming, and you gotta have it hardwired in. That's just kind of the way it is, and not everyone really has that option. So I really hope that they have more of a download experience, but it does look like, I think I talked about that in my last video, looks like we are getting more backwards compatibility with PS1, 2, and 3 for the PS5. And definitely 4, like I was talking about, where it's a free upgrade for all Ubisoft games and Cyberpunk. God, I do not mean to plug this a lot, but man, that's good. Arizona RX Energy, it's an herbal tonic. It is not an energy drink. It's not bad for you. It just has like 24 grams of sugar and 300 calories, but it's meant more of a snack. But I digress. So we're getting the Xbox event in July that kind of will, I guess, make Xbox look, you know, a little bigger in the pants, so to speak. They'll have, we'll see the Halos. I guess we're going to have Fables, and I guess we're going to have all the classics there. But yeah, so I guess Sony, when they had their event in June, I guess they're still holding their cards really close to their chest, and I guess we are actually going to be getting more games in the rumored August State of Play. I think it sounds like they held back a lot of titles. We've been rumored about the Silent Hill. It sounds like Sony is buying the Silent Hill IP franchise, maybe a Metal Gear type game coming out. But it sounds like Sony smartly held back game announcements, both first and third party games to really, I guess, counter that. They knew Microsoft was going to come back. You know, Nintendo is its own thing. I know I talk about the war between Sony and Microsoft a lot, but you're never gonna cancel out what Nintendo is doing. I guess they were going to work on a Switch Pro, but that never happened. So I think they're just going to... There's been small rumblings of their next-gen console, or at least they're talking about it. I mean, they have to be when you got powerhouses like the PlayStation 5 and the Xbox One Series X coming out. But yeah, it sounds like Sony smartly held back a lot of game announcements at the June event because they knew Microsoft was going to come back with another event because Their first foray into next gen was just a fail. Everyone was disappointed. And I'm not trying to hate. That's just the way it was. I mean, I'm a gamer of all gamers. I think it doesn't matter. Let's just play on any platform we prefer. And hey, I mean, I owned all the Xboxes before the Xbox One X or the Xbox One, period. I just never picked it up. I was in college and did a lot of stuff and had to choose one because I was a poor ass broke college kid. So I just went with the PlayStation because that's what I've been going with since I was 7 years old. It's really all about the continuity, really, with sales at the end of the day. But, you know, I have nothing against Xbox. I think they did a great thing with the backwards compatibility. It just seems like now that we're finally moving into next gen, hopefully all that work is for naught. But like I've been saying, this generation still has a lot of life left to live. Even at the end of this year, even when we do see the next gen consoles, we'll still be seeing plenty of cross-buy and cross-platform titles to make sure it's an easy transition. But that being said, it sounds like Sony is also doubling down on the production of the PS5. It was a Bloomberg, it's from the source of the Bloomberg, and you know, they have a lot of news about everything, but They're saying that Sony is really doubling down on the PlayStation 5 production. They know demand is going to be high, especially it sounds like, it doesn't even sound like, we're already kind of going into the second wave of this pandemic. Things are really hard, and gaming has just, in turn, have had a great boom because of people staying at home and social distancing and whatnot. I mean, it's one of the best things you can do at home. I mean, you can only get so far with backgammon, but... that being said, it's just a beautiful platform to do at home and to do with the people that you're living with. It's multiplayer, it's online play. There's just so many pluses to gaming. It's just the new medium, you know. It's just as high as your next movie blockbuster, and movies aren't even a thing. Gaming is somewhat outlived movies right now. It's just more accessible. So in Sony, it seems like they're going to be making a shit ton of PS5s. It sounds like they're going to try and reach 10 million PS5s to meet demand. I don't think they'll actually reach that number. I'm still going to pre-order mine as soon as I can, but it might be a relief to some of you to know that they're going to be coming out with a bunch of PS5s. I would still recommend pre-ordering it if you can, if you hear about it. And of course, you'll know from me... when you'll be able to pre-order the PS5 and the details. Yeah, the July 13th thing didn't go through. We were supposed to be getting pre-order information 2 days ago on July 13th, but that didn't happen. I'm so glad I didn't camp outside my GameStop for that. But we will be getting it soon. We're only months away from the supposed launch of these titles or these consoles, so we got to know about the price. We got to start saving up for it. I'm going to, of course, try and get it right away. I've been going crazy on the games. There's a bunch of stuff I want to stream for you guys. But just be ready to maybe try and pre-order the PS5 if you really want it at the moment's notice. But it sounds like with the high production, it sounds like we will be getting that $400 sweet spot price point. Hard to say, at least for the digital edition, the sad edition, I'm going to call it. But, I think the... disc-based Blu-ray version will be closer to $450. I'll pay the $500. I know I'm going to be getting a solid, rock-hard console that's going to play the games I'm going to want, especially with titles like Resident Evil 8 Village being exclusive to next-gen. I'm gonna need it. I need my games, guys. I'm just a man with needs here. And I know you all are too, so just be ready, but it'll be a little bit maybe easier and lax to get a PS5. Towards the launch or close to the launch of the PS5. So just be on the lookout. I'm going to be talking about it. So apparently we are getting this rumored state of play in August. We'll definitely get more titles revealed there. I think we're going to be getting the Silent Hill, maybe release dates for Demon's Souls. I'm just so glad that's a thing. Maybe Digimon Survive. I don't know. I really need my Digimon, guys. I ordered my premium Bandai Digivice 2020, and I don't even care that I'm not seeing it until February 2021. I just need my damn Digimon game. But that's just, you know, a 90s kid's small cry, if you will, a plea of... But we've been extremely spoiled. We've had a great year of gaming, and Sony has definitely delivered on their end, especially, you know... Now, I just want to make sure I get all my... my PlayStation news. Yeah, we talked about the backwards compatibility stuff, and then Bloomberg suggests we'll be getting close to 10 million PS5s at launch. And but yeah, it sounds like it's really, I guess the manufacturing isn't that bad. I guess it's the shipping constraints. And I've actually ordered a bunch of stuff from GameStop, and it's taking like 2 weeks to get here. I wanted to stream a bunch of stuff for you all, but it just seems like I'm not going to be able to stream it as quick as I can. I'm going to be moving soon, so I'm sorry if the stream's coming a little bit slower, but I'm going to be definitely getting that out as much as I can to you. I have some great titles I want to play. We're getting the Daymare 1998 Black Edition, which is originally a fan-based Resident Evil 2 remake, but then, of course, Capcom was working on that, so they told them to stop, but they just made it their own game. And Resident Evil 2 does take place in 1998, so... I guess it really is a love letter to survival horror, not action horror, survival horror. But also, I want to do, speaking of Capcom, I would love to do a Devil May Cry full playthrough for you guys. And we're going to be getting Mortal Kombat 11 Aftermath. I'm finally going to check out the DLC and the post-story to MK11. So make sure you just please follow, hit the bell, like, share, subscribe. You can check out all my stuff on YouTube. I'll plug this a little bit more at the end, but just would mean a lot, guys. This channel is growing. There's so much more of you joining with me every day, and it just really means a lot. So, and I love to do these weekly Dubisodes live. It just feels more of like a real show, you know. You go to school all day and you pick your nose and you have your little milk pouch, and then you get on the bus and you run home and you try to catch the next episode of Dragon Ball Z. But sorry, I'm getting freaking out here. I'm a little tired. I had some turkey today. But yeah, so anyway, I digress again. Sony has treated us very spoiledly this year, and we just got The Last of Us Part 2, still sinking that in. Definitely want to do a retrospect. I'd say, just a real quick note about The Last of Us stuff. Love the game. The gameplay was very similar to Last of Us Part 1, so you can't really ding it there. The gameplay is solid, but people were just really pissed about that story. I see where they're coming from. The focus might have been a little off, but I'll talk about that in a video for another day. But seems like people are finally stopped talking about The Last of Us. They're just letting it be its game. People are platinuming it. It's, of course, you know, kind of an easier one. There's no multiplayer online trophies, so you can really kind of just get through it at your own pace and kind of see all the things you miss. Lots of cool collectibles and things to explore there, but, you know, The Last of Us, it was a Neil Druckmann experience, if I do say so myself. He really was pushing the boundaries there. But, yeah, that'll be a story for another time. But, yeah. We've been very spoiled, and just right around the corner in a couple days, and I was talking about shipping constraints. I'm really hoping my GameStop is getting this. I got the collector's edition for this game, where I'm going to hopefully make a whole stream schedule and go live with it on Friday. I'm talking about Ghost of Tsushima, the last big PS4 exclusive of this generation. Developed by Sucker Punch, the guys who did Infamous and Sly Cooper before that, so they know wholeheartedly what they're doing in the gaming realm. I've been getting so hyped. Reviews have been good. I watched a Digital Foundry of all the real cool, minute details. Of course, this is a Sony first-party AAA game. We've been so spoiled, and yeah, really, this is coming off the end of July here, and we'll be getting, you know, smaller titles in the future, like Destroy All Humans. We got the collector's edition for that coming up. I'll be showing you that. We got Cyberpunk, of course, coming in November now. That was pushed back, and we have Avengers, and we have the smaller titles. We have Assassin's Creed, so we have a lot of Ubisoft stuff specifically, but you know, really, this is kind of the last big hurrah for the PlayStation. It was originally seemed like, hey, what's up, Swanee? Yeah, I want it too. I really do want it too. So it really seems like, you know, we're going to be getting a very solid last experience here. It was originally going to be The Last of Us Part 2. Like, The Last of Us Part 1 was kind of the swan song for PS3. It seemed like Part 2 was going to be the swan song for PS4, but just with everything going on in the pandemic and whatnot, it seemed like gear shifted a little bit, and Ghost of Tsushima just needed to be the end-all, be-it-all here, and it's been getting really good reviews. And of course, we don't have the user review scores here, but I'm just going to bring it up here a little bit. We're getting the... yeah, this is the current Metacritic score of an 84. That's really good. Last of Us scored a 96, but I'm sure the user reviews will be much better for this game. It just really seems like Sony has really taken that long, hard road of making sure their exclusives and their first-party titles are kind of really just similar to what Nintendo is doing with Mario. and Legend of Zelda, where you can really only play these experiences on your own console, and that's really the, I think, the true battle here. You know, you can only play certain titles on Nintendo's console because they're so damn genuine, and you can only play certain titles on PlayStation 4 and the coming up PlayStation 5 because Sony's being so damn genuine, and they make sure that their developers are taken care of. Insomniac, yeah, was recently now part of the PlayStation Studios brand that they're creating to really know that you're getting into a true PlayStation experience, and I'm sure Sucker Punch is well under this wing now of the Sony first party. And we even did see that in the June event where they did play the little, I call it the Marvel's Avengers opener, where it shows, you know, Nathan Drake and Kratos and Ellie and Ratchet and Clank, and they're all doing their thing, and then it comes together in a neat little package of the PlayStation Studio logo. So it just really does get you excited and knows that you're really getting in for a true hardcore experience. So yeah, I'm just really excited for the Ghost of Tsushima. It seems like this is gonna, you know, it's another home run for Sony. It's, they really haven't missed the mark, and they must really trust their people, especially in a first party. Yeah, their last game was Infamous back in 2014. It's been 6 years. They've put a lot of work into this game, and it just, it looks beautiful. It sounds like gameplay-wise, I guess it might be best when you're just roaming around in your horse through the grasslands of Mongolia. It's the Mongol Empire invasion in kind of a 1200 BC or AD. I'm not sure the time frame here. I'm horrible historian here, but really just seemed like a last home run hit out of the ballpark experience. We're having, it seems like reviewers have been saying there's true inspirations from Sekiro's parrying. And yeah, again, I just gotta really mention how funny it just seems like all the genres are kind of the same with all these first party Sony exclusives. I mean, with Spider-Man and Death Stranding, even God of War, they all have these open world elements with slight RPG type gameplay where it's an action adventure with just a wholehearted, well-written story. And that's okay, you know, by me. I don't care if the genre is all kind of the same. We've gotten plenty of smaller PlayStation exclusive titles that'll mix up the genre a little bit, like Tetris Effect and Persona 5, you know, like a true RPG experience that you can only play on PlayStation. And yeah, they've taken some of their titles and made them accessible to the PC, but hey, I'm a gamer that says if you got a game and you got your console, make sure as many people can play your game as much as possible, because you don't put all that time and effort into a game just to limit it to one console. I think Sony is just kind of being a little open-minded, and seems like they opened up their minds a little bit to the cross-play with Microsoft and, of course, the Switch, and Microsoft boarded on that first, even poke fun at Sony for kind of holding back. But I think their ego is super high, you know, respectably and understandably, very high ego for Sony right now. They're riding their high horse, and that's kind of where the 10 million units are coming from that they're supposedly going to be releasing, is that they just think they're going to blow the competition out of the water. And you know what? I agree. All of my friends have become Sony players. Most of them, anyway, a lot of them who used to be an Xbox have slowly moved over to PlayStation. And, you know, I don't want to say it's because of the games, but some of it is because the games are just really good. And, you know, it gives you that movie experience and it gives you that gaming experience all in one at the highest fidelity and quality you can get coming up on the twilight of the end of this generation. You know, we're almost moving on, and now's the time to kind of gear up and play all the games you can. I'm kind of feeling a little freaked out here, like I'm not going to finish all these titles, which is why I really hope that they do figure out the backwards compatibility thing. I'll definitely will be keeping my PlayStation around, my PS4 around going into the PS5. Maybe I'll trade it and I do have the Spider-Man PS4 Pro. currently, I really wanted to get that mid-generational upgrade when I got the an actual true HDR 10 Samsung TV. But, you know, TVs are getting cheaper, but not everyone still has the true HDR experience. And the technology-ness of it all really does play a factor in having the best experience that you can. But this is just my little talk that I have about going into next gen. Don't mean to digress too much here. I'm super stoked for Ghost of Tsushima. From what I've seen, it looks really amazing, incredible. I just couldn't be more excited. I thought I was gonna be satisfied with The Last of Us Part 2, and I was, but you know, I just need this one last experience to send me off. I think, you know, for me, it really started when God of War 2018 came out. I know we had titles before that. We even had titles like Nioh. You know, Nioh 1 is a PlayStation exclusive. It's on PC now, but Nioh did it. We saw Infamous Second One. Second Son be the first, exclusive. But then Bloodborne. I didn't have a PS4. I was a poor college student, even post-college. I didn't have the resources to get a PS4, but I guess Bloodborne in 2016 was really that first solid must-have exclusive, especially if you were a Dark Souls fan, to get a PS4. And then, of course, we had the Pro come out. And then we had then Sony came in really hard. I mean, we had, you know, the upgraded version of Grand Theft Auto, and Sunset Overdrive came out for Xbox, and they remastered all of Halo. So we definitely had our little picks of games that came out for the early of this generation. But then Sony just, man, they went super ham with God of War, and then Spider-Man came out. And then even the smaller stuff like Nioh 2 came out and Sony exclusives. And then, of course, you know, we had, Horizon Zero Dawn. I got to stop forgetting about that game. Came out in 2017. Even The Last Guardian came out. The long-awaited Famita Ueda game. Sony just had a great, great, great fucking generation. This whole past couple years here, and they just hit it, and they really wanted to make sure that you got your money's worth, and they have amazing, incredible sales throughout all the PlayStation Store, and they're doing it like every week now because of the pandemic and everyone staying at home and just enjoying the beauty of gaming right now. I just got to give a huge shout out to gaming. And so Ghost of Tsushima is coming out this Friday. Hopefully I can start that at about 1 p.m. I really hope my GameStop gets it. I was talking to my guy today, and there's a very teeny small chance they won't get it on release day, but I got the text message, so it's got to be legit, right? And then, of course, after Ghost of Tsushima, we'll do the final thoughts. We'll have some more stuff. But yeah, then we'll have smaller titles like Destroy All Humans come out. I'll be playing Devil May Cry, 1998's Daymare. So I got a lot of stuff lined up until we start getting really strong with Cyberpunk, Marvel's Avengers, and a lot of the games closer towards the end of the year. But yeah, thanks, Dubes. That's going to pretty much call out for the Dubisode, the weekly Dubisode. We got through some news. We got hyped for Ghost of Tsushima. Just wanted to talk with you about kind of the current state of things, and the PlayStation 5 was a lot of fun. Thank you so much for watching. If you can, please give this video a like. Please share it. Subscribe on my YouTube channel. I do cross-promote between YouTube and Facebook, but the outreach for Facebook has just been a lot of fun. So been using the platform more and more and more. Welcome Mixer community. And I'm not even going to get into the whole Dr. Disrespect thing, or, you know, just the state of a lot of current day YouTubers and Twitch streamers. And, you know, I'm just a little guy in my own little lonely PlayStation Island. This is primarily a PlayStation channel, but we do talk about Microsoft and just games in general. I'll always just give a shout out when I can. Yeah, Paper Mario, the Origami King, is coming out Friday as well. So huge shout out for Nintendo finally putting out a Paper Mario game, and they announced it out of nowhere just a couple months ago. So I haven't really checked the reviews. It seems like the embargo is being lifted for a lot of games, and I think a lot of the reviews for that will be coming out Friday. but we will be streaming Ghost of Tsushima should, fingers crossed, my GameStop gets it. Yeah, dudes, that's going to call it for today's Dupisode. Thank you so much for taking your time to watch me. Yeah, please hit that follow button so you know when I go live. I don't have a direct schedule right now. I just kind of go live at any given moment. That's just kind of the way it is. I will be moving soon, so there will be a little bit of a transition there, but promise you it's going to be worth it, delivering you all the best content at the best quality. This is Dube Radical here with uncuts, unedited content. Sorry if it's a little long, but just want to show you how do we get from A to B without any cuts, baby. Of course, as always, dupes, have a great day. Thank you so much. And as always, we'll be right back.